Next, we are introducing the joint speaking corporal. Okay, next, we have our friends. Eritrean people, as you know them, they have been struggling for the Eritrean people, and still they are struggling for the transition, democratic Eritrea. Christina Björk, Bo, and the others. And we have also here a guest from Social Democratic Party, member of the parliament, Mr. Ahe Hamadnaka, and Social Democratic Party Association, 10-star branch, Muhammad Noor, originally from Somalia. And again, let us say welcome.
زغبركم تسعة تبعت من سكرم
شحن شعبتك مثل السامحاني بمسارة فدرالاوعي إيرترا كان شحن شعبتك مثل حمسان كلتين حساب شحن شعبتك مثل السلستين بسم من قصة إيرترا أنا يجزى حساب ومن محدران كم في نظرة إذو العزي بإتيابكان بمشاهد كتنا بروس الفاع من نتن ببور فرس مستمري لو ما بقول تزحل بتاريخ بقول كما لعقي إنسا ياسل مشاهد كتنا بحيتن كي تدو زفرين بزي أكاد عن إزي كنزي الكرون كنن اللي ينزلونا تصعبوتا إزبي إيرترا كنزي مصر حادث إزبي إيرترا زعفتو لمريد الحسن بوليتيكا وبرتاو قاسي كرتي وكرات هكذا واحد نظام واحد تاع ديمقراسية أولوتي سلسي هزبي إيرترا دحرنات اللي تنلو لها نتعاملو نتغطو بيز الحي مسألة تاون ديمقراسية أول مسألة زي الرقابي أربعتي داب ما يسدتن ودتن مطرحتن هزبتا إيرترا إزي يمبار لو مشي كنستنتن زرنا أربعتي ودرات كبرات كبران مسكر رماوية نتغارس نفتح الديمقراسية عن إيرترا سرعات الكبراغي كم تنع كل جزئ بحصوص وبطعو لهون بمهنيات سنبيل بحث مسكر رم التشعر عزر تعمشته والكبراغي نقول مش لذاته لهم الشفاء أبتع حصوص معقل زينو تيري إيرا نايب الدعين تعقيت المريض صحبه معنا ويكاهي يهو نحن نتعرض سير فتح عندنا تنزل إيرتراهي انتهي من كبير عبارة إزوون نايرو مشي رتوي نسوز بلو خندك نزي كونس نحن عاسي زبن تعبون زي للول سفع استراتيجي أو شينا كل توف تحنا زبنا نفرقا بيصالو حق إنيا نبار نحادنا نقبل زبن رتوي كبوران كبورات تزاتك توان مسكرة وانا تصفات تسبيتن نزبي اترا كبورات كبوران نعدوما نزبي اترا بحافشا افراي حيدي هاقل تغوني من السينا دماء وفلاي هذا ذاك فعنكي شكوران سبتة الموتو بيني الكبار من سي اترا وشتاقي قبونا استفرالي نسدت بوتاتات دقات مطلو اسكاح كاي كلاتات كلها نفرتون كتاتر مثل زغنا من قاموا أبنزي أدائي مثلهم لو مكين إتي أبجنيغا سلام وصل في استطاعت في حيلي من سي تسفاد على الزبنان سل زغني مع أنتو شد أبنو هاقراو على أبنتو تغنزيبو نسرعة الدف سعيرو أب إيرترا ديمقراسية أو لغوتي نمرغات أب قد درجة لغوتي بمسوق بارو بس تاريخ هوا قاتامي نحنا أتوم قدائي بسرعة عواتي قوينا كن كبرون كن حقزون يقبعنا انبر بفرحات التقارية كبريهم يبنا بس غائيو ابنتنا بزارنا يومشي كتعبي زلوه كبورات كبوران عدوما أبدو كذي يزي دعري عصر شي تستعمتا كاسنا كابل الكنات نام ديموكراسيا قلع وانتاهم عباريتا أوش تيرت عن دقين دم تقاومون نديموكراسيا ولوتي نام ناي حبر استراتيجي أنفت قلتو خمرة دا أنا برومب أب موغن ناتر متحنبال جزيون حيلون كتف يبنون إذا مشيت زون بزي كسرتنا والله إذا معت زيا كلنا عقرب من حيلتنا عقمتاتنا وحالات أبيتنا ندعنا تسبنا عقرب إيرترا بعتوب النت طالع سهراوي من طعنا إن أطلع معتيه سلزي كل دلائل بتعين سلام إيرترا من هي تقول نوع تقول سلام وعقمتاتو كانت على فوان العلي هو في تلاوه بفلاي ما من سيادنا أب كندي مسحة مردلا أب كندي متحمماي كندي متعمماي منا عسل دماء عم مخببار مصوبوار زلو قولتكا هاو نغط فترو التنزبي إلترا زبوغو لوتي خدريو كتوك عرسو دا عمبر عبزي فلاري أكلا ساتات كتوك عرسو قزيو أيكوري إزي نخبرو سلونا معاتوون نمارسي عبدا نزم الأخذي كما حلاف يفتو أبدا مدنتا إدمينا أخبركم نزاتا لغاوة مراتيزيا للمخبار أبدت رغيكم تلوه حواتنا حاتم كل زميلة مسكارانا من وراء أبدت لكزي ملكي كاباكنا تغطيتو علامة تاتنا علامة تحت مسكرم بمنو ترغاقيتو أوش تهزبنا بحبار كنا بقلوم تسفان بيبن يغني اللي كبرم يغني مجاكار سواعدنا أول نهزب إلترا
أموكم من الدين نجم الديمقراطية والأرزالة في إلترا الضيوف الكرام السيد بروفيسور دان كونال المحترم أصدقاء إلترا إلترا جروبن كريستينا بيورك أبو ومن حزب الشاشات الديمقراط علي محمد ناكا ومحمد نور. اسمحوا لي في البدايه باسم وباسمي وباسم المناضلين الشرفاء طالبين الحريه والديمقراطيه ارجو جميعا بالشكر في زيد بالذكرى انطلاق الكفاح المسلح 54. نحن اليوم ذكرى انطلاق الكفاح المسلح ونستسحب معنا كل الذكريات والاحداث التي خاض فيها شعبنا النضال السياسي السلمي من 1941 الى 1961. شعبنا مر من اجل ان ينال استقلاله وحريته وواجه كل التحديات الداخليه كانت ام خارجيه حتى الى ما البطل محمد ادريس عواده مع بعض رفاقه الكفاح المسلح في جبل عدن حتى نال شعبنا استقلاله بعد 30 سنة من التربية. وعبر الاستفتاء في سنة 1993 تم اعتراف بإريتريا كدولة مستقلة ومعترف بها دوليا. واليوم يواصل شعبنا الأبي نداءه ضد العصابات الحاكمة حتى ينال كامل حرياته وحقوقه الإنسانية. ضيوفنا الكرام، بفترة الانتقال كانت إريتريا تتمتع بحكم فدرالي والدستوري من 1952 حتى 1963. الآن والاستعمار الإثيوبي وشريكه حزب الأندنت ألقي الحكم الفدرالي الذي واصبحت إريتريا تحت الاستعمار الإثيوبي. ونخشى اليوم أن يعيد التاريخ نفسه بوجود هذا النظام مع شريك في تثبيت على رأس السلطة. وبهذه المناسبة التاريخية لا بد من ذكر بعض القضايا الرئيسية المهمة. تجربة مريرة للنضال السلمي والكفاح المسلح في الشعب الإريتري، قيام الوحدة الوطنية هو المهارة للتغيير الديمقراطي، قيام الاستقرار بعد كل هذه التضحيات، لجوء الشعب وخصوصا الشباب ما يتعرض له من تهجير المصري. سيطلع علينا رأس النظام عبر قنواته المرجوة للكذب، وكعادته سيحمل كل فشله وخلاقاته على خارج. ولا نتوقع شيء جديد، وهذا يحملنا مسؤولية أن نوحد صفوفنا ونوجه أسلحتنا نحو النظام حتى نحقق سلام واستقرار شعبنا. يتعرض شعب الإريتري بخصوص شبابه إلى أبشع جرائم من قتل والتعذيب والتشريد من وطنه والموت في الصحراء والبحر. ولكن بالرغم هذا كله هناك براقة أمل، وهو ما نراه في المظاهرة التاريخية في جنيف، في حضور كبير من الشباب. وهذا يحملنا مسؤولية نضالية كقدماء تجاه هؤلاء الشباب في توحيد طاقتهم وأخذ بأيديهم وتوجيههم نحو القضايا المشتركة. وفي الختام أود أشكر جميع حضوركم معنا والمشاركة في هذا اليوم التاريخي، ونتمنى أن نلقاكم العام القادم في أسمرة لتحتفلوا سويا بسبتمبر الخالد. المجد والخلود لشهداء الأمرار، النصر للشعب الإريتري، وشكرا.
We have opened the celebration. We are celebrating Bahtun Askaram, or the start of the arms of the Eritrean people. We are commemorating the past and thinking about the future. The future is transition from dictatorship, unexpected thing in Eritrea that has happened. And as you all know, our distinguished guests, with this day, we have our guest from USA, as our friend has presented him, Dan Conell. You know, all of you, Dan Conell, who is Dan Conell, and what he is going to present shortly. Dan Conell has been in Eritrea in 17 or at least 17s. He has struggled, he has contributed by his pen, he has contributed physically, and still he is struggling for the democratic transition. I'm not going to elongate my presentation or introduction to Dan Conell. Today Dan Conell is our honorary guest, and we will leave the podium for him. He will be discussing, he will be presenting his topic on the current situation, crisis, refugee crisis that the global is speaking about. He will only present his field research findings, and I welcome Professor Dan Conell to the podium. And again, applause for Dan Conell.
Because, in fact, early on, I got myself enclosed within a kind of cocoon of the EPLF. So I will show you some slides of my experience in those years, and they are only through that lens. And I am ready to acknowledge that that was not the whole picture, and to those who are outside of that lens, I apologize. I may also get asked by supporters of the government, what about the successes of Eritrea in the last 20 years? Now, in fact, I actually wrote a book for the Ministry of Information in 2001, celebrating the successes up to that point. It was published as a handbook of Eritrea shortly before I was kicked out of the country. You know, there's also that side that, as I said, I can't tell, but I know is out there. There has been massive progress in the repair of infrastructure, the construction of schools and clinics. But I have been talking to many of the people who did that work and who did the teaching in those schools who are now in refugee camps in the surrounding area. And that's another side of that story as well. I am often asked, how did you get into this situation in the first place? That's what I'm going to start the presentation with and take you back to my experience. And I hope that you will feel free at the end of that to ask any questions that you want, and that you will at least save them until that point, and I will do my best to respond. So how did I get into this in the first place? I became involved in politics at home in the United States in the 1960s. My first protest demonstration was actually 1962. When I was protesting in front of a store called Woolworths over the exclusion of blacks from the lunch counters in the southern United States. It was a time when the civil rights movement was developing throughout the United States. I was in Washington in 1963 for Martin Luther King's famous I Had a Dream speech, and I was active in many struggles around racism at that time, and then in the struggles that emerged over the United States participation in the Vietnam War. And it was coming out of that political experience at home and the increasing awareness that what I was seeing in terms of injustice and inequality at home was reflected at a global scale that I made a determination to travel outside the US and particularly to look at the American role in other countries. I was fascinated by the changes that were taking place in Africa at that time as new countries were emerging. The decolonization process was in full swing. It seemed a very exciting moment of creation and also discovery. The situation that drew me initially, in fact, was that in Ethiopia, I have to confess. There was a revolution taking place in Ethiopia. Haile Selassie had been overthrown. A socialist military junta had taken over, declaring a revolutionary path for Ethiopia. And who was supporting them? The United States. You remember, in 1975 and 76, the US was still backing Ethiopia, attempting to demonstrate that they could support a radical nationalist regime, and perhaps underneath it, realizing that the rhetoric was not necessarily as real as it may have seemed. I went to Ethiopia in 1975. I spent off and on about 4 months in Ethiopia, going up to the Ogaden, traveling up to the feeding centers in Wolo, looking at the aftermath of the 1973-74 famine, and trying to see what was the dirt doing out in the countryside to make real the promise of a revolution. I found enormous contradictions on the ground, and particularly when it came to a mysterious war that was taking place in the north in Eritrea. There were no journalists allowed there at the time, so there was no coverage, and it was almost as if the story didn't exist. I met several Eritreans in Addis who began to tell me stories about what had gone on. I met one Eritrean who tried to offer to take me and my friend who was traveling with me to the Mercado, and I watched as Ethiopian thugs beat him to the ground for talking to me, right outside the National Bank, if you know the space down at the bottom of what was then Churchill Boulevard. All of that opened up to me the fact that there was something up there that needed to be understood better, and that the United States was deeply involved in it. So I went to the Relief and Rehabilitation Commissioner, or the Deputy Commissioner, and I got permission to go up to Tigray to the feeding centers. I got up that far and I just kept going. I got out on the road with my friend who spoke Italian. We met some Eritrean truck drivers. We explained that we wanted to go north, and they took us up to Maitri. There we got out on the road again, and again we met two Eritreans who worked for telecom. They were coming back from Diridawa with a pair of little Volkswagens that they had picked up there. And they had been out to Diridawa, I think, because the Africa Cup was taking place, or there was a game going on out there. And they agreed to take us into Eritrea. They took us to Makale. They knew people inside the administration there who would give us permits to go farther north. We went up from there to Aksum. And we waited, actually, almost 2.5 weeks until there was a call for a convoy. And at that point, everybody in the area who had been waiting converged on Ottawa. So at 4:30 or 5 o'clock in the morning, there was a line of some 400 vehicles, buses and trucks and cars, and a convoy that was being escorted by Ethiopian tanks and troops, all of whom, of course, were wearing American uniforms, with U.S. often stenciled on the belts because they were surplus from the Korean War. It took us 3 days to get to Asmara. We spent one night in Adikwala, where I had some of the best sua in my life. We continued on to Adiubri, to the Mandafero. We spent one night there. It was very slow because we were worried all the time that we could be attacked by the guerrillas who were outside. I was really eager to meet them, to learn more about what was going on, but I didn't want to meet them at that point. We got to Asmara, and I stayed in a little pension next to the cathedrale. It was called the Lake Tana Pension. The name was changed later. Second night I was there, there was an assassination across the avenue at Nebyat's bar. This was Colonel Bishu, who was killed. He had been the man who led the convoy in. He was killed. The whole city shut down immediately. The Ethiopian troops went around the city shooting up at everything that moved. We stayed very quietly in our pension, as did everybody else who was around. The next day, everybody went to work, and at about 4 or 5 o'clock, everybody went home as quickly as they could. And then the troops were out on the streets again more quietly, going around to people's houses, following a list of suspected sympathizers with the ELF and EPLF, and pulling people out and executing them as a lesson to those who had supported the national movement. Seeing all that, I was very moved, and I went out and started asking questions about the experiences of us Marinos. And despite the fact that the United States was backing the regime, and I was there as an American, people took me into their homes, into bars and restaurants, and told me the stories of experiencing the same kinds of things over and over again for many years. I left. I flew out to Aksum, actually, and took a bus south from Endesalasi. And I wrote a long story. I took it to the headquarters of the Washington Post in Addis Ababa, and they sent it to Washington, and it ended up appearing on the front pages of the Washington Post. By that time, I had gained some information about the Wodazamach, the first peasant campaign from Lee. Somebody who worked at the American Embassy gave me information about this. And so I had a new story and another story. I went from there to Khartoum immediately. I made contact there with the ELF and the EPLF, and I asked to go into the field to see the situation from that side. I had to wait 5 weeks before I got the permission while they checked me out because, not surprisingly, an American asking to go into the field at that moment was a questionable affair. Actually, it was Hagar Skeverjewik who was in charge of the investigation of my political background. And I had to write a biography of this. They checked me out in the US and I finally got permission. I went into the field then with EPLF. I was met outside of Port Sudan by Najdi Kifu, who took me inside, and I was turned over to a young kid who was going to be my guide. He was a fighter, hard to distinguish from others. He didn't have any front teeth. Some of you may know who I'm talking about. So it's a hot effort. But nobody identified themselves or their position in the front at that time. I only learned about this a year later. I spent 2.5 weeks with the EPLF, and then I changed in Kabasa with the ELF, and I went out to Tesfay with ELF, spending about 2.5 weeks with them. The next year, I went back again, and I spent 6 months in the field, wholly with the EPLF this time. And that's where the lens gets skewed to one side of this situation. My slides will start right at about that moment, and I will take you back through that story. And just to give you a few of the insights that I have taken out of it over the years since then, and then we will work our way as quickly as I can up to the refugee situation starting in 2012. So, if we can get the lights down here, I can get it.
Okay, bagaimana woman yang aku tak please off cell phone. Ali, Allah, di sini sekarang. Okay, no, okay. Okay, it is okay now.
Camp there. This is all women. Women course, were playing a growing role within both fronts at that time, and had been since about 1973. There was also an extensive public health program, and in fact, what struck me in that first visit to the field was, and the time that I came back, in the beginning at least of 1977, was not so much the military activity as it was the effort at transforming the society. And I think there was a very important lesson which lies all the way through my first book, Against All Odds, that making political revolution side by side with making social and economic transformation is what builds a base of a movement. And it was that ability to meet the immediate needs of people in a very concrete way and measurable way, I think, that helped to generate the depth of support for the ongoing military and political struggle. There were also schools using textbooks that were created and printed in the field. And of course, this was a remarkably efficient and well-organized movement. All the visitors who came in the first few years there, whoa, somebody just hit the wrong light. I think, did somebody just...
No,
light. Yeah. Keep that one off. Keep this one's off. I think there's still a light up there. Can you get the light off? It was sometimes disquietingly efficient. Every time you would ask people for the reason that they were struggling, the goals of the struggle, you got almost the same answer, which was often disquieting. And the reason for it was, of course, there was an intensive political education going on, where fighters and members of the other departments were meeting often three times a week for political study using that book that you see in the middle. And that was being led, of course, by what we later learned was the secret party that guided the front, the Eritrean People's Revolutionary Party. It was not clear at the time, but since that time, it's been very obvious that that is behind what a lot of the discipline and regimen that we saw came from. And of course, that's a strength at one level and a great problem at another. I was there in 1977 at the end when the Battle of Massawa took place. I was down there when the EPLF went into Dogali, and then when they tried to capture the offshore island in the port and also the naval base. And that, of course, is the turning point in the war, because as we learned quite quickly, this was the start of a major Soviet intervention on behalf of Ethiopia. I talked with prisoners after that who described having Russian advisors in the trenches with them, working with them to man the artillery, the mortars, and giving them strategic advice on the whole campaign. And the EPLF suffered some major losses in that campaign as well, as we saw from where we were. There were cluster anti-personnel bombs, there were fire bombs of various sorts. It was really almost a radically different army that we faced at that time. And by June, of course, of 1978, the Ethiopians were in full invasion mode, coming into Eritrea through Tigray, from the Red Sea, through the air to various towns and cities, and then exploding out on about 13 or 14 different fronts. And very quickly, the fronts had to retreat and move back until the trenches were drawn in the Sahel. Now, this is a shot of the trenches outside of Nafra that was taken in 1991 by my wife. And of course, it's very different then, but I included in the slides just to give a quick visual sense of the way that the mountains themselves became a fortress, and the trenches, which were then covered with logs and dirt and rocks and disguised from the air, were practically impenetrable. The Ethiopians tried repeatedly to come up those mountains. They couldn't do it with their artillery or their tanks, so they sent wave after wave of soldiers, thousands of whom perished there. I was also in Nakba in 1979 during the fifth offensive and witnessed it myself. I also went back in 1979 determined to see what else was going on behind the lines, because outside, the politicians and the media were saying this war was finished, that little Eritrea facing big Ethiopia had no chance, that Ethiopia had the support of a superpower while Eritrea had very little. So it was only a matter of time before the mopping up took place and the war would be over. I was convinced that the secret weapon here was the Eritrean people, and the commitment and support that the fighters had from the people would make a difference that the politicians and the media couldn't see from the outside. So I went to the boss, and I asked for permission to go behind the lines to see for myself what was going on. We had quite a lengthy exchange on that before I finally got permission. And I set out from Nakba with a small group, actually, walking up around Afabet, up through Geleb, down to Sheb, and around from there, there I am, Mugabe, making tea, up through the mountains and up as far as through Filfil to the outskirts of Asmara. Everywhere I went, there were still fighters who were camouflaged as before, whoops, and they were running, again, schools and clinics, carrying out other activities, and controlling much of the territory outside of the cities and towns. The Ethiopians, like before, were largely inside the cities and towns, and they had control of the highways and roads during the day, but not at night. The whole situation increasingly moved in favor of the Eritrean side during those years, with the two major detours. One was the outbreak of civil war in the early 80s, when the EPLF with TPLF allies drove the ELF out of Eritrea and became then the only armed force left in the field. And two was the famine, which began to develop in 1982 and 83, and by 1984 was growing increasingly severe. The loss of life in Eritrea was real, but not as extensive as in much of Ethiopia, Sudan, and other areas hard hit by it, largely because of the organization of the relief effort. There was a huge problem here in that most of the relief was going to Ethiopia, and Ethiopia was using it in the cities and towns under its control within Eritrea and also Tigray and elsewhere to draw people out of rebel-held areas. And they were not permitting food to get into the war zones. So what food did get in Eritrea was being trucked in often to distribution points like this, and then put on donkeys and camels and taken further afield. It was a well-organized effort. I saw, this was in Zara, I saw feeding centers here where food was distributed according to lists that had been compiled in villages. There was never any fighting or contesting for getting in line for food, as you saw in other countries, because Eritreans were much more disciplined than that, and the system was much better organized. We all know what came in the late 80s, the situation changed. I won't go through the whole history of the struggle. In 1991, the final battles were fought outside Asmara, and the war was over. In the very beginning, I was in Asmara with my wife again, who took some of the pictures that I'll show now. in October of 91, not long after the end of the war. And at that time, there was enormous excitement and great happiness, as you can see here, especially among the kids, and great hope for the future. There was enormous damage as well to the country. The roads were badly destroyed. Almost nothing had been done by the Ethiopians to develop or even repair much of the infrastructure. I can remember it took us 11 hours to get from Asmara to Massawa by bus. This is the middle of Dekamhare. That building actually got torn down. But people were coming back from outside with great hope and expectations that this was the chance to finally build a new, dynamic, free, and prosperous country. There was one big exception here, and that was that the EPLF didn't permit the ELF to come back, or any other organization that was outside that identified with the nationalist movement. And that was a big warning signal that things would not be as open as many had hoped at the time. But many of us, myself included, allowed the situation to develop with hope that the rule of law and the consolidation of civilian state would permit these kinds of things to be argued out and fought out in a different arena. The referendum, of course, took place in 1993. Again, there was great celebration. The spirit of volunteerism throughout the country was visible almost everywhere you went. In Nakba, they were rebuilding shops. There were new roads being extended out into the countryside, roads being repaired, dams being built, hills being terraced, and trees being planted throughout much of the country. I was in Ambaderho, where the village turned out to put together the dam that some of you, I'm sure, have seen since that time, giving the community a year-round source of water for the first time. But with all the hope that went with that, with a constitution-making process that engaged people in many, many parts of the country, things began to get difficult with the outbreak of conflict coming first with Sudan and the planting of mines and ambushes by the jihadists coming out of Sudan. And over the next, the middle part of the 90s, of course, Eritrea fell into conflict with every single one of its neighbors. The biggest, the most destructive of which was the war with Ethiopia, which, of course, broke out in May of 1998. I was in Sarona in 99, in the beginning of 99, when the second round broke out. And there were the fighters back in the trenches, just as they had been in 1978. And in fact, we can come back to this, but I would argue that what Eritrea has turned into is not a state with established institutions, but a large liberated area with a guerrilla movement controlling it with a larger level of territory, but much the same structure and mentality as that during the war itself. When issues began to get raised about the conduct of the war and about the failure to implement the Constitution, which had been ratified in 97, of course, and postponed until a year later, war broke out, and then that became the excuse to put it off indefinitely. And in the summer of 2001, the arrests began with students and then continued, of course, with the G15 and with hundreds of others afterward. And the door closed on all public dissent or difference. This is my symbolic door. That door is actually in Haikota, but it, I think, tells the story. This was a time where I would say there was a kind of struggle going on inside Eritrea for what future direction it would take. And those who believed in guided democracy and rule from the top and control over the vast majority of the society performed a kind of a coup from within and shut down any opposing views.
And unfortunately, that has been the case ever since. In 2002, after I gave a few interviews on the arrest of the G15, saying such radical things as if they've committed crimes, they should be given trials and due process, I was ousted from the country by none other than the man who had met me in Port Sudan in 96, Naizgi Kifler. And I have not been back since. As I mentioned in the beginning, in 2012, I determined to try to get back as close as I could to the situation, especially with the rising numbers of Eritreans leaving the country, to try to understand that experience and how it reflected on the situation inside. So I went to Ethiopia, and I went up to the north. This is a UNHCR map from that era. And it's not a very good scan, but the camps, of course, were up in the north. There were three at that time. The oldest one, still in use at least, was Shemelba, which was established in 2005 with the movement of people from another location to that. But the Shemelba is the northernmost camp. It has a very significant Kunama population, as well as Tigrinya speakers, Sahos, and some others. But it's notable because of the large number of Kunama who are there. Many people have been resettled since 2012, since I was there. I was just back there again last June. But you can see it looks like a village because it's been well established over time. And people have made their homes and businesses there as well. The camps, like all the other camps, are administered by the Ethiopian Refugee Authority, ARA. The UN supplies all the food, and there are several international organizations active in it, the International Rescue Committee, Norwegian Refugee Council, and some others. But it is a meager and difficult existence. This is Adi Harush, which at that time was a new camp, and this is what it looks like in a new camp, where people who arrive are given tents. After some time, they begin to add building materials to the tents and turn them into more settled housing. But this is an arid, impoverished part of Tigray, where it is extremely difficult to get by, even if you are from that area. Many of the people who are in these camps, of course, are highlanders, many of them from cities and towns, unused to this kind of existence. If you've seen the coverage of the migration, the migrants and refugees over the last several weeks, and you followed this kind of a situation, you know that what you usually see is families, women and children and older people making their way out as refugees. Many of the young people go off to find work. Especially the young men. These camps are very different. Young men make up the largest portion of the population. It's turning the demographics of a refugee situation almost on its head. Why? I think we all know the answer. It's because most of these are national service conscripts and they're coming out to escape prolonged service. I interviewed, as I told you, hundreds of them over the time that I've been doing this research, particularly the last year. And they tell stories. In some cases, there are young people who have gotten called for national service, seen problems with their older brothers and sisters, and left. But many others have been in service for 5, 6, 7 years, some of them 12, 15, even 18 years. I've talked to people who were conscripted in 95, released after 18 months, recalled in 98 during the first round of the border war, and never got out after that. Some in the military, some as teachers, some in positions in ministries, and throughout, of course, the society. Many working on agricultural plantations. They leave in part because of the indefinite character of the service, but also because of the abuse that they have suffered in the service. From superiors who have put them in jails and prisons, sometimes tortured them in front of their colleagues. You, I'm sure, are familiar with the positions, the helicopter, Otto, and these others, where people are tied up with their hands and feet behind their backs, left out in the hot sun for days at a time. Some have been put in prisons, in some cases underground, in some cases in the coastal areas in big warehouses, places like Kalima down near Assab and the Daleks. Their crimes sometimes, thinking about trying to escape. Their brother, their sister, their husband escaped, and so they are suspected of assisting them. People have been caught praying when they're in the national service or in the military. It could be Christians, it could be Muslims. People have been arrested for standing up in a meeting and saying, when can I go back to school? The stories of arrests and punishment are quite extraordinary and disturbing, in part because the people who tell them, when I've talked to them, are not trying to win asylum. They're just recounting their stories, and often they have broken down into tears as they've told them to me. They've told me in great depth and detail about being imprisoned in Allah, as I mentioned, Kalima, in Track B in the middle of Asmara. And there has been developed a kind of a culture of thuggery where if you question this to anybody, you get doubly punished. So there's no accountability or recourse if you have any doubts about the justice of your treatment. Meanwhile, back to the refugees. We have also a growing number of unaccompanied minors, which I saw as early as 2012. These were the boys, the girls. Sometimes they would come over in twos and threes, sometimes by themselves. Often they were looking for a brother or a sister who had gone, or a parent, and they weren't there in the camp. So now they were by themselves and not sure where to go next. The Ethiopians were keeping them in separate areas to try to give them some security. But of course, the danger of being trafficked is always real. I went back again to the same camps in June this year. And I ran into this sign, which I think kind of epitomized the condition of many of the people in the camp. I don't know where I'm going, but I'm on my way. There was a sense of hopelessness about the situation, not only inside Eritrea, but in the camps. For young people who wanted to work, they wanted an education, they wanted their freedom, and here they were in another dead end in the camps. So the camps, unfortunately, were turning into kind of way stations. Many of the people that I had met in 2012 had left by 2015 and gone to Sudan and on to Libya. Nonetheless, there were more coming constantly, and my eini, as this is, was full. What just happened? The other really big difference in the 2015 visit, though, was how young many of the people were in the camps. There are many, many kids coming across. Sometimes they live in the border areas and they just walk across. Sometimes they're from deeper inside. But the whole border area from Adikwala through Tsarana, Sanape, must be missing huge numbers of young people, because that's where many of these kids are from. I went to Hitzatz, the newest camp, also in June. And this was the most arid, the hottest, and the most remote camp of all of them. It is huge. There were some 40,000 people in it at the time. A very large number of them were young children, unaccompanied minors, who were being put again in a separate compound. Norwegian Refugee Council was working with them and setting up separate housing for groups of them. But they were coming in by the busload almost every week. and it was getting very difficult to keep up with it. The tragedy of the situation here is that as the United Nations has been reporting a flow of people of record numbers ever since last November coming into Ethiopia, the funds available for their work have dropped by 10% this year. And I think this is a function of the competing priorities in the world today and the kind of faddishness sometimes of these kinds of situations. If they're not right out in front of you, you may just forget about it if you're living outside. So as an aside, I think it's imperative that all of us capable of sharing stories on this and advocating more media and other attention to it should make that a priority. But if these camps are fading from public view, those in the Afar region are almost invisible. On my last trip, I made a point of trying to go into the Afar region, and I went to there are two camps out there, Asaita and Berhale. Berhale is up near the Eritrean border. Asaita is off the road that goes between Addis and Djibouti, which is a very busy road, as you can see. It's the main corridor, of course, for Ethiopia's access to the sea at this point. So they're, incidentally, widening and doubling the capacity of the railroad and also the roads. But the roads were full everywhere I went. I went off the road, of course, to get to the refugee camp, and it was practically like being in the Sahara. It was, of course, the timing was difficult because the winds were picking up and it was the dry season. But this is really forgotten land out here. It is as hot and dry and dusty as you can imagine. The Ethiopian Refugee Authority manages these camps as well. The UN supplies food. There are almost no international NGOs involved here, though. It's as if, as I said, the Afar aspect of the situation is lost. And Ethiopia, as you may or may not be aware, puts all the Afar refugees who come into the country into these camps, and also some of them, of course, melt into the Afar community without getting into the camps at all. And Tigrinya speakers, and Saho, and other non-Afar are moved to the Tigray camps. So this is a kind of ethnic federalism applied to the refugees. So all the people in the camp here are of Afar origin. There may have been a few exceptions to that. I spent some time in the tents talking to people there. I'll actually be writing about this very soon. Their stories are somewhat different. The Afar tell many of the same stories about national service and other problems, but they also talk about ethnic and religious discrimination, problems they've faced in their home areas, often in Assab, going to offices where nobody spoke Afar, and they were forced to bring translators to do any business with the government. Where they were being restricted in their fishing and their trading and in their traditional agriculture and having their cultural traditions undercut. So they were feeling a kind of double oppression here that came from the generalized situation and also that specifically aimed at them as a cultural minority. Despite the fact that at every celebration in Asmara, somebody does Afar dances, there is a long way to go before they feel included in the society, and I think that's an issue to just put out there that needs a good deal more attention, along with that of the Kunama. The other thing you may notice in these pictures is that there are families in these camps, that whole families have left at the same time. I was in Asaita at the time that some people were coming from Yemen. They had escaped from Yemen after being there for sometimes many years, sometimes even decades, because of the attacks by the Houthi militia there. And they were coming across by boat to Djibouti and coming into Ethiopia. And I met one family of 25 people, aunts and uncles. It was an extended family, all traveling together. These are people who will tend to stay in the area rather than to migrate out as individuals, as happens in the camps in Tigray. But as I said, they have very few services, and their housing is much... Some of these slides aren't working. I don't understand what's happening, but I'll have to just skip through it. It was nighttime. This is what some of them look like in the camp. You can see it is a lot less developed than the camps that we saw in Tigray. This is a shell of a frame, basically, that the UN gives out together with the tent. The winds have destroyed the tent, and that's what's left. The biggest crowd I saw in the camp was gathered around a list of people who had been identified for second round of interviews for resettlement. And that's the only hope that the people out here really have, is resettlement in a third country. The United States, Australia, Canada, or other countries. I also did, this past May, go to Djibouti. And I met some of the people who were coming from Yemen there, and I also got out to the oldest camp in Djibouti, Aliade, which is on the southern border of Djibouti near Somalia and Ethiopia. It is off in the middle of nowhere. It's 30 kilometers from the nearest settlement. It's at the end of a dirt and gravel road. Where you get, I'm looking at the camp from here as we're coming in. It's over that hill, the road ends there. And to leave that camp on foot is almost certain death. The largest number of people in this camp are actually Somali. There were also hundreds of Eritreans and several hundred Ethiopians who had fled to Djibouti in 1991, when Assad fell. And they had been basically stuck ever since with their families. The Ethiopians and the Eritreans here had developed a kind of solidarity, particularly among the Christians, because they were very nervous about attack by the Somali extremists, the Islamist extremists within the Somali community who were operating there. And the international aid agencies didn't seem to be aware of it. For reasons that are a puzzle to me and certainly to the refugees. But I went there and I had a chance to talk to people also about their experience. Most of the refugees in this camp, the Eritreans, are Tigrinya speakers. The Afars tend to melt into the Djibouti population. They have cousins, they have relatives, they have other ways of existing within Djibouti. So the United Nations counts only maybe 1,000 refugees there that are registered with them. But there are thousands more that are interspersed within the local population. But here too, you see settlement not unlike that in the Afar region that I showed you in Ethiopia, but perhaps even less developed. Once again, there's very little outside aid here. The Lutheran church, actually, here we are in Sweden with the headquarters of the Lutheran Church. The Lutheran Church is running the school there and helping with the clinic. The Norwegian Refugee Council had put in latrines and some small amount of work. Otherwise, nobody's doing anything. These people also are nearly forgotten by the world, and I hope will not be forgotten by all of us. I also had a meeting very like this one, but you can see the circumstances were quite different with the Eritrean community there and heard the stories of their escape across the border. Often, as they came across the border, particularly young men, they were arrested by the Djiboutians as enemy combatants because, of course, Djibouti also still has a hostile relationship with Eritrea. And most were held for weeks, months, sometimes even years in jails until finally they were released in April of 2014 and sent out to this camp. A significant number of those who had been held all that time have moved on to other places, but there were nonetheless several hundred who were still stuck out here. So, if I can just jump from here to the surrounding area, in my research over the last year, I went to 10 cities in Canada and the United States, and then I came to 6 countries in Europe to interview people about their experiences, why they left. I'm not going to show you any pictures of that. I think you know a lot of those experiences. And besides, showing photographs of people getting interviewed is not terribly exciting. But I want to take you to Israel, where I was twice in the last 3 years, the last time last January. And incidentally, in February, I was in Kenya and South Africa as well. Israel, of course, started getting refugees in the mid-2000s when the way through Libya was shut down, and a growing number made it to Egypt and through the Sinai to Israel until Bedouin smugglers discovered that they could make more money by holding on to people for ransom than by taking them to the border and releasing them. It's hard to know exactly how this started, but I think you're all familiar with the story. It's a terrible one of thousands of people being held in torture camps in the Sinai out near the Israeli border. As people stopped going there voluntarily, the Bedouin traffickers started buying them from Rashida smugglers who would capture them in Sudan, in Shagarab camp, in the border region, sometimes inside Eritrea, sometimes inside Ethiopia, and transporting them in pickup trucks there. I went to Israel to interview survivors of that experience and also to learn something about the experience in Israel, where there was, by 2013, when I made my first trip, already a strong backlash from right-wing Israelis against the Africans in their midst. And of course, 2012, you may be familiar with it, there were many reports of violence, of firebombings of people in apartments, and other action taken against the African refugees, most of whom were Eritreans, and some of whom were from Sudan. But the racism behind this was directed at them as Africans without really distinguishing where they were from, what their experience was, or whether they deserved asylum. The Eritreans there, as you undoubtedly are aware, are not treated or even identified as refugees by the Israelis. They call them infiltrators. Now, the reason for that is that the Israelis are masters at controlling the language of politics. By using the term infiltrator, it puts them under a 1954 law that was passed to try to stop terrorist attacks within Israel. Now, it's a big stretch to suggest that there is any relationship between the Eritreans who arrived there and that phenomenon. But it avoids having to treat them as refugees under the international refugee conventions that they have signed. There, I think, have only been 3 Eritreans who have gotten asylum in Israel in the past year. There were 35,000 when I was first there. Having said that, there were also many Israelis who were humanitarians and in solidarity with the refugees and who were turning out, as we've seen happen. Today, I happened to be in a demonstration here in Stockholm. I don't know if many of you saw that, but there was a big demonstration on behalf of the refugees, welcoming refugees, where people chanted, no borders, no nations. In Israel, there are NGOs and volunteer groups that come out and provide food in Levinsky Park in South Tel Aviv to the refugees, or were at least in 2013. There were other intellectuals and artists who had put together a library, which was something very appropriate to the young people who were coming to Israel and hungry for learning. There were human rights groups as well who were teaching people Hebrew, how to adapt to the society, teaching people about their rights, and trying to do some post-traumatic counseling, especially with the young people and women who had been through torture and often serial rape while they were in prison in the Sinai. I was also there then in 2013 when there was a demonstration against the refugees by right-wing nationalists who wanted all Africans out. You can see right in the middle of that the symbol of the time bomb. These are people, of course, who see any development of Arabs, of Africans or others, as a demographic time bomb that will destroy the Jewish character of Israel, and they want them all out. Unfortunately, the power of these groups has influenced the government tremendously, so that already at that time they were building a fence that would keep people out, and they were passing legislation to prepare the way to detain and deport the Africans who were living there, particularly, of course, the Eritreans. I'm happy to say at least that there was a small group of Israelis who were protesting against the racism on the other side of the street, but they were in a minority at this point. During the time I was there, I went to the southern part of the Negev, to the Saharanim prison, where Eritreans who were coming in were being detained at this point, or others who were protesting or were caught without the proper papers were being sent. I also went to the border fence itself, and this is the kind of fence that the Hungarians can only be jealous of. It runs from the Mediterranean to the Red Sea. It has electronic sensors all along the way. Nobody gets through. A handful of people get into Israel because soldiers see them and they let them in, but it's very, very difficult now to penetrate. So they have effectively closed the door, and if you're following this in the media, you know that they're building a fence around the other side of Israel, facing Syria, in a similar way, creating what I would liken to a gated community, the kind of situation where the wealthy, even among us, put themselves behind fences and guardhouses and keep the rest of us out. And that, unfortunately, is the strategy of the Israelis. And I also had a chance to interview some of the survivors of the torture. One of them was a former computer operator who was hung by his hands until he lost the use of them. I don't want to linger on the photograph, but he is in Europe getting treatment now. You may actually know who he is, but there were a handful of people that were getting reasonable treatment there, but the Israelis were tightening the restrictions on the refugees even then, and they've only gotten worse, and I'll come back to that in a moment. But first, I just want to take you to Egypt, where I went next in 2013. Cell phones off. I think many of you are familiar with Dr. Alganesh from Milan. She arranged for me to go into the Sinai with her in June of 2013. I went to the Sudan and also to Egypt at that time, and I went into the Sinai. We traveled by car to El Arish. We hid the car in a garage there, changed cars, traveled at night with a driver who had an AK-47 under his seat. It was a lawless area that we were moving into, in much the same way that we have in some of Central America, where the drug traffic dominates. Here it was people traffic and other kinds of smuggling as well. But there were, like the Israelis standing there with the no racism sign, there was Sheikh Mohammed, a Muslim, who was organizing in his mosque to rescue the kidnapped victims, claiming that this was haram, it was against Islam. And I had the occasion to get there the day after they had rescued 9 people who had been held, in some cases for 5 months, by the torturers. They also videotaped it on an iPad because this is modern world, wherever you go. And I've seen the videos, and actually I copied one of them. They went into the compound with their guns going, shooting into the air, not at anybody. Took control of the compound, took control of three of the traffickers. They found nine people huddled in a corner, still in chains. The people, of course, in chains had no idea who was coming in with guns and didn't know what to expect. Finally, they thought maybe it was the police, but it wasn't. It was a kind of civilian posse by the chef. The next day, I went to interview them. This is a guard who was there because of the danger that the traffickers might come back and try to recapture them. Oh, no. Too many problems here. That's the first thing I have to say when I'm teaching. All students, cell phones off. Same thing. Well, you guys, turn the sound off and just leave the vibrating part on if you have to go out to answer it. But it's very disruptive.
Okay.
Thank you. The people who had been held for this long had been repeatedly beaten while they were forced to make phone calls to relatives, maybe some of you, to pay the ransoms. Ransoms that ran as much as $30,000-$40,000 or more. Here's a boy whose family couldn't come up with money, so they just stopped feeding him. You may have seen this photograph because Alganesh has it and she's been using it as well. I know he is okay now. He went to Cairo. And in fact, what Alganesh was doing was she was taking biographical information from all of the prisoners, the released free prisoners. And we were taking photographs of them. And then she was going to the United Nations office in Cairo and getting papers for them so that they could leave the Sinai. Because once they were freed from the traffickers, if they were caught by Egyptian police, they'd be put in prison and possibly deported. So they weren't safe until they had papers from the UN. This is a photograph of the chef in the middle, Alganesh there on the far right. And all the captives. One of them is an Ethiopian, incidentally, who was picked up in the border area. He's just a migrant worker in the border area not far from Kassala. So, Israel. Back to Israel. Do you remember the... Well, we're not going to see it. The situation in Tel Aviv when I went back was very different. The tents and feeding station had either been shut down or curbed way back. The community was in disarray because the Israelis had started detaining Eritreans who had come before May of 2009 and taking them to Holot detention center on the southern border. There's still some contest happening in the Israeli courts over how long they can hold them. But many people have been detained there and put in very bad conditions and then pressured to self-deport, to either go back to Eritrea or to go to Rwanda or Uganda. And the Israelis were offering at the time $3,500 to go, which is ironically what many had paid for, paid to get there in the first place. But they were really smart in their own insidious kind of way here. Because they were arresting the people who had been in Israel the longest. You might think that normally they would go after the most recent arrivals. But by taking the ones who had been there the longest, they were weakening the base of the community. They were taking the people that had learned Hebrew. They were taking the people that had jobs, that had stable living situations, that could play roles as advisors to other younger people coming in. So they were both taking specific numbers of people out and weakening the community at the same time. And I heard stories from some of the human rights workers and the people working in clinics who described increasing problems of domestic violence, of alcohol abuse, and of depression within the community. Not surprising, given the conditions. So this is a quiet tragedy that's developing within that community, while the more visible part of it, of course, is those who are detained and who leave. Halat is a weird kind of semi-prison. It's described as a detention center, not a prison. It's right across from Saharanim, the full-scale maximum security prison. But people can leave it during the day and go out to the parking lot. Sometimes if they have the time, they can even get on a bus and go to the nearest town and come back. But they have to keep checking in regularly. So they're in prison all the time, with some periodic releases. I was able to interview people here about their story outside, and I have written stories about every one of these experiences, which incidentally I have published and posted on my personal website. And I'll come back to that later, but if you want to read more about their individual experiences, you can find it there. Here's the prison right across from it. When some people tried to launch a protest a year ago by marching out of Halat and going down to the border and saying, release us, let us go back to Egypt, the leaders were all put in the prison for 3 months. But one of the more disturbing things that I saw when I was in Tel Aviv, when I went back, was this graffiti, which is right outside Levinsky Park, the sort of center of Eritrean activity in the city. I don't know if you can see it, but that black stencil there says, Ausländers raus. It's German. It's a slogan from the 1930s in Germany, foreigners out. And it was put around German cities against the Jews. And here it is appearing with a symbol of the Israeli nation above it in that six-pointed star. I surprisingly ran into one Eritrean who had been detained in Halat and had decided to leave. He had been given $3,500 and flown to Uganda. When he got to Uganda, he took that money and he traveled to Khartoum, and he arranged with smugglers to take him from there to the Americas. He had, of course, to add money from relatives to get to the amount that would get him there, which I think in his case, 15,000 US. I talked to others who had to pay more than that. But I went to South America in March of this year, to Ecuador, to Quito, to follow the trail of the Eritreans who have gone that route as well. And I had talked to quite a number of them in the US who had reached there and gotten asylum, one of whom had scanned all the documents from the hotels he stayed, the planes that he used, and the travel agents. And emailed them to himself so that when the smugglers destroyed all their papers, he still, being a young person who was tech savvy, had a complete record. And he shared that with me, and I followed the trail that he set out, not all of it. He had flown from Khartoum to Abu Dhabi, which was the headquarters of the smuggling group. They had given him fresh papers, identifying him as an Ethiopian migrant worker. He was flown to Moscow, and then Havana, and then Quito, Ecuador, where he was met by a smuggler who took the papers and destroyed them. Many others told me similar stories, flying to Brazil, sometimes from South Africa, from Kenya, but ending up in Quito in Ecuador, which is about, let me try to say, 6,000 meters above sea level. I tend to think in feet because we still do that. It's 10,000 feet above sea level. It's way higher than Asmara. It's a mountain city. They started here without papers and then traveled from there with smugglers on buses, pickup trucks, boats, trucks, and on foot. They had to take buses through northern Ecuador to Colombia, through Colombia to the northern border and to the Caribbean. Some took a boat across part of the Caribbean to the Panama coast. Some went across the river and went in directly. But Panama does not connect directly to South America. I didn't even know this myself until I was there. There is no road that connects South and North America. There's a strip of wilderness in Panama along the border. It's called the Darien Gap. It is almost impenetrable, forest and swamp. There are dangerous animals, insects, trees with thorns that you have great difficulty getting past. There are also drug smugglers from Colombia. There are also counterinsurgency troops from Panama looking for the drug smugglers. So it is a very dangerous passage. One more of the many dangerous passages that Eritreans are making around the world. I didn't take this picture. I didn't get into the Darien Gap. I actually took this off the internet, but I just wanted to give a shot of it. This is a river that runs through there. There are indigenous people that live in this area as well. The smugglers pay them often to take the refugees and migrants on the boats through parts of the area. And in one case, my informant took a photograph of this. They're all Eritreans in this boat. There are some 70 people in this boat. He's only partway back on it. It's a big, long boat. You could start calling Eritreans the boat people. But they are going, they're mostly young men. They're not all men who take this trip, sometimes women, sometimes children, but it's a very difficult and dangerous one. Here you can see a woman in the picture, a couple, I think. They're out there eating rice from a banana leaf. Here's Fessa in the middle. He's the guy who gave me the pictures. He now lives in the United States, happily. But the trip was complicated all the way through Central America because this is the area controlled in large part by drug gangs. So the passage through each country was dangerous. They started in Panama City. They stayed in the poorest part of the city in a hotel here where many migrants stayed. They go from there by bus, by these colorful buses, up near the border. They get out near the border and go on foot around it. They sometimes follow mountain trails. Sometimes they go through the jungle. Sometimes, as I mentioned, they may be on a boat. Making their way up through Costa Rica, Nicaragua, Honduras, and Guatemala. I picked up the trail again in Mexico, where they get to the southernmost border town of Tapachula, and immediately they are detained by the Mexican police, which I have to tell you, after all they've been through and all the risks they've taken, is a relief. This is a high security detention center, but they at least get a bed and they're safe and secure. And in most cases, after 1 to 2 weeks maximum of interviews, they're released and given papers to travel across Mexico. The Mexicans treat the Central American migrants differently, but there are Africans coming through here, mostly Eritreans, some Somalis. I also ran into Ethiopians and Ghanaians, but the bulk of people going through here were Eritrean. And they, once they get out, they stay in a small hotel that caters to foreigners, particularly the Africans. Right across the street from here is an internet cafe, which is all they need, of course, to continue. And from here, they're legal in Mexico. Very few stay in Mexico, partly because of the language issue, partly because they don't have family or contacts there, and partly because they experience racism in Mexico as well, against Africans. It's a difficult passage in that way, and they find themselves very alone as they travel through here. They fly often from here or take buses up to the U.S. border. They go to California or Texas. I chose to follow the Texas route, and I went into Reynosa, Mexico, and then walked across the bridge. Some people that I have talked to have paid smugglers to go by boat across the river there, the Rio Grande. Some have tried to swim themselves, but most actually just walk across the bridge. You can enter it freely. There's no guard at the Mexican side of it. You go onto the bridge. You walk across to the other side. And there you meet the immigration officials from the U.S. where you say, I am from Eritrea and I would like asylum. The Americans immediately detain them and they go into what is are some of the worst detention centers in the U.S. Sometimes right there in Texas or California, sometimes they get distributed in other places. They have a hearing which, if they make a credible case for asylum, and pass, they then have the opportunity for release if someone outside will sponsor them, a relative, friend, church. Otherwise, they stay in detention until they have their final hearing inside, and that is the worst outcome that they can have. So this trip across the Americas can take anywhere from 3 to 4 weeks to several months. If you add up this with the experience of Libya, the Sahara, Libya, and the Mediterranean, together with the trip through the Balkans, and I've also talked to people who have taken that route, you find Eritreans in every possible situation taking enormous risks to get out. When I asked the people in these situations what they wanted and would they go home again, most people, especially recent arrivals, said they would go home again in a minute. Who wants to leave their country? Most people also said they weren't opposed to national service. Some were, I have to say, but many were not. They were opposed to not only the length of it, but the character of it, which is something that I think many Europeans now having conversations about so-called reforms are missing. And that had to do with abuses and also the uses to which many were put, working sometimes in plantations and other jobs that seemed to benefit only their military officers rather than the country. But they were also talking about the problems of having no choice over any of the main decisions in their lives, where they would go to school, what they would be sent to do for work. Sometimes work that could last a decade or longer. No freedom, in other words. And so I think it's really imperative, and I do my best to make this case when I talk to people in the justice ministries and other immigration authorities that deal with this, that they recognize that what they're dealing with here are genuine refugees, leaving often for deeply personal and political reasons, and not just coming out to try to find better lives, although that's clearly also a part of it. But given their choice, if there were a way to find a better life in Eritrea, I think they would happily go there and contribute what they could, as well as getting back what they feel that they deserve. And I hope that we see that day where it's possible. And that's where I'm going to stop.
Okay. Then, Dr. Then, that's right, okay? 3 chances.
Thank you, Dr. Conell, for your presentation and for telling us our story, the story of our compatriots, both the glorious ones and the not so glorious ones of the present, which are happening right as we speak. This has been, of course, overshadowed by the events in the Middle East, and and thanks to you and many like you, has been exposed now. And your contribution to the Eritrean cause is immensely appreciated, I have to say. My questions are so simple or just short, and I will start with the camp at Shimelma. I was perplexed to see these young people as with the age of 5, 6, 7 or something like that. Is there the possibility that these kids were actually born there? Any statistics on that? Number two, on the Afari side, you say the Afari refugees are isolated, and I was not so sure about why they were isolated. Now it became clear because I heard your lecture last Thursday as well. So on whose authority are the non-Afaris being forced to leave the Afari camp? Has anybody asked it, or does the United Nations know about this? This is a very important question to be answered, I think. And number three is also the educational system. I know all the youngsters, our brothers, sisters, kids, they are ready to leave the camps, but many of them are stranded there. And how is the educational system? Is there any way we can, what shall we do to help them to start any educational system? Is the United Nations doing any kind of that work to alleviate their at least their life? Because it's quite a waste of age and years of energy and having them on that campus. Thank you very much.
Yes, make a couple more, and then, or shall I do it one by one?
Not one.
Okay.
Please shorten your question. Shorten to gain the time, and you will get also the exact answer.
Okay, I also have to apologize for going on so long and making this so late. There's just so much to say. I want to thank you for the promotion. I'm not actually a doctor. I incidentally have two university degrees. They're both in English literature. I am field taught in journalism and African studies. And I am a visiting researcher at the African Studies Center at Boston University on the basis of practice. You asked questions about Shimelba and the kids and the Afars, and particularly about the education issues for, I think, all the camps. And this is a profoundly important question. You know, I went on so long that I didn't get into the what to do about it part of it, but I hope we can focus on that, and maybe you give me an excuse to talk a little bit about that. There are certainly children who have been born in the Shimelba camps. The Kunama community there, like the Afar community, tends to include whole families. Whole villages sometimes came across the border. They tell stories of having land seized from them. You know, the Kunama have had difficulties with the EPLF going way, way back for many years. There are similarities between the two communities. The Afar community is a little different in that it has been isolated geographically and politically within the country. Physically, it's isolated. So there is that phenomenon. It's also a situation that has something in common with the Kurds. You have Afars divided between Djibouti, Ethiopia, and Eritrea, three different countries where they're minorities. There are all kinds of issues to take up there, but the isolation and separation and cultural differences have a long history. It's not just the current refugee situation. But I think it highlights to me the need for any kind of movement toward democracy and openness in Eritrea to be also as inclusive as possible now, with all of us paying attention to everybody, so that when Eritrea opens up more, it is an Eritrea for everybody of whatever political persuasion or ethnic or religious background. And I think if the groundwork isn't laid for that early on, it isn't going to happen later on. I was confronted over the past year by of our activists who said, what about us? You're always telling the story of the Tigrinya speakers in the camps. And so I made a point of going out to understand better that story, and I'm going to go back and do more of it, actually, in the coming months. And I think that needs attention, as I said, from all of us. On the children, there are children who have been born in some camps, particularly Shemelba, but there are also an increasing number who are just coming across the border by themselves. Sometimes, actually, they get encouraged by families to go across, I have to say. Sometimes they're coming across without their parents having any idea where they are. They just disappear, small groups of them get together, and they come across the border into Ethiopia. They have some fantasy that everything is going to be much better because they've seen often families at home receiving money from people who are outside, and they think, all I have to do is get out there and I will find some enormous opportunity for myself, and they find them instead in these really terrible camps. The United Nations is doing some work with education. There are also international NGOs that are doing work. The International Rescue Committee in particular is, many of the camps have schools for young children. What's missing often is the education and training opportunities for the older ones, for the ones who kind of, because there are so many coming in between 16 and 25 who have partial schooling and want more, and there is not much to offer them, and they're the ones that then continue on out. I think much more could be done on the education front to increase the opportunities for schools. There are some schools in the Sudan that have been supported, the one going back for many, many years in Wacharife, some of you may be aware. There are other schools in these other camps that could be expanded. I think that one of the things that we can do outside is to provide specific help there, but also advocate with international aid agencies to put more efforts into it. If the Europeans are concerned with all the migrants coming here, then the first thing they ought to be doing is improving the conditions in the neighboring countries where all these people are coming from. And that actually goes for Jordan, Lebanon, and Turkey as well, in the case of the Syrians. Somehow, it's a cliche, but everybody wants to deal with a crisis when it's at their doorstep, but not where it's coming from. There are a wide variety of training programs that are also important in this area. When you get to older people, though, it's not just the training and the education that's missing, it's work. If you're sitting in Maini or Shemelba, let alone out in Asaita, and you get trained to do something and you get educated to do something, what do you do with it? The Ethiopians have been running an out-of-camps policy, as some of you may be familiar, where people who can prove that they have the capacity to support themselves can get released to go into the cities and towns. That program should be expanded, and it should be subsidized by outside agencies. And I'm not suggesting that you and I have the money to do that, but Sweden does, the United States does, Norway does, Switzerland does. They should be putting more money into those kinds of programs so that people who are in those camps, who demonstrate a capacity and a drive to better themselves, can go into the cities and towns and not only get education, get work. Sudan has no urban refugee policy. It needs to have one. They are only dealing with people in the camps, and yet, I think as most of you are aware, a vast number of refugees are coming into those camps and just continuing on to Khartoum and Omdurman and melting into the population there until they can get out. It won't solve the problem, but if Sudan would have an urban policy that recognized people and gave them status and allowed them to stay there, it would slow down the very dangerous treks that many people make across the Sahara. I think what we can do here is bring these situations in front of the media. Find people in the community who have stories to tell and get them to tell them individually to the media, because that's what the media thrives on, and put pressure on politicians, aid agencies, and the media to support more work in these camps to make lives more secure and also more reasonable from the standpoint of education and work. There's one other little issue I just want to throw in here that maybe you guys can help me with. One of the things that many people told me in Ethiopia that made them less anxious to stay there was the inability to communicate with families at home. That, I believe, is because the Asmara government has blocked phone calls coming from Ethiopia. That simple thing would be a gesture from them of concern toward other people of Eritrean nationality, wherever they are, and it would change things, I think, in a small but significant way for people, and maybe we should all push for that as well, those of us who have any interest. I hope that answers at least part of the question.
Next, Dr. Vestam. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Dan. Great to have seen you actually live. I learned a lot about you, read a lot about you, seen you live is a great honor, really. And my question is very simple. The first is, of course, your background. You started about the Eritrean situation when you were young, about the Vietnam, U.S. war against the Vietnam. And you saw the results of the Vietnam war, I guess. And when the U.S. pulled out of Vietnam, and the situation of the Vietnam didn't become any good. And that was the case of the Eritrean situation when you saw that in 91. Wouldn't you have reacted a little bit different based on that background? I mean, you have a Vietnam background. What I'm trying to say is like the Israel situations where the PLF kind of commanding the Eritrea. Wouldn't that have been a sign to you? Because you're a journalist, you're educated, Western guy, have seen the globe.
Okay.
Yeah? That's the first question. And the second is, of course, about the opposition parties in Ethiopia, in Israel, about the refugees that you're seeing. Do you see any signs of those people doing any kind of relief help?
Okay, good
yeah.
question.
Yeah,
good
thank question. You.
Got it. So the first one, I think it's a question I get asked every time I'm in a situation. I totally understand it. What took me so long is basically what you're asking. Let me go back and say that there... part of the problem that you see in Eritrea is not unique to Eritrea. Every armed movement that has built a culture of secrecy and top-down control and authority has had trouble making a transition afterward, and we've seen that with many different movements. So I think part of the problem could have been anticipated simply from the situation of how does a military movement make a transition to from resistance to government. And the warning signs were there in many areas. They were there certainly way before 91 too. I was familiar with the incidents in 1973 and 75 with Menka and Yamin and others. And in the 1990s, I think I mentioned in the beginning, a critical sign right at the front end was the refusal to allow the ELF to come in as an organization into the society, not only the ELF, other groups as well, or new ones to form. There were more after that. There was the shutdown of NGOs as they formed. I can remember women fighters who had put their lives at risk and given enormously to the liberation struggle, being demobilized and trying to start daycare centers and being shut down because the National Women's Union was already there, so this is duplication. Well, it wasn't really about that, it was about control. And that wasn't the first time that I personally encountered those issues, but that's it's a long story there. So there were innumerable signs in the 90s that this was a movement that had extremely serious authoritarian tendencies and a tendency toward dictatorship that was, I argued out with Yamani and others, the need for opening up the arena of ideas to simply have debates over the economic and political future of the country. And I came from South Africa, from seeing how powerful it was there, and was told it would never work in Eritrea. And the thing was that I, like other people who were inside the movement, kept trying to balance all of the things that we saw happening that were positive with the negative ones against the hope that the establishment of the rule of law would create an environment in which these things could finally be resolved. I think in retrospect it was naive. I think Isaiah should have been stopped in 92, 93 when he took control of the state and began to create a new mechanism of control. The seeds for that were planted way back in the 70s and in the 80s. The 1987 Congress, the party before the Congress, the Front, where the leadership was changed, if you look at that, was part of a creeping coup. I mean, this is a long process, right? You know that. I know it better now than I did then. I should have been paying more attention. And you know that. I'll tell you one final story, because I could go on for a long time on this, and will in my memoir. There was a point in 2000, well, you know that if you're familiar with my book, Conversations with Eritrean Political Prisoners, of course they weren't prisoners when I interviewed them, but it's that I became convinced that the role of the party inside the EPLF was really a key to understanding all those warning signs that we were seeing in the 90s that you're starting with. And that the habit of control from within an organization where you saw a face of an organization. In the case of the state, you saw ministries and parliament and judicial system, but the real power wasn't there. The cabinet were a bunch of NGOs really doing implementing policy that was being decided somewhere else. It was just like the EPRP setting the agenda for the EPLF, going into congresses of the EPLF with the slate of leaders already decided, the program already written, and then a kind of charade that this was going to be a democratic process, okay? So I started investigating the party, and I began talking with Duro. That was the first conversation in that book, and it was that look at the party which led me to write a paper on it. I presented it in the summer of July of 2001 at the Eritrean Studies Association. Sharifo and others came up to me afterward and said, you know, you got part of this right, but you're missing a part. So then I started talking with them. That led to the book. So it was really the party part that I was trying to surface and get out. And that's what got me in trouble. But there was a moment that came a little earlier than that, in June of 2001. Before the big arrest had taken place, but after the meetings had started, they actually started in January in the PFDJ in the middle ranks of denouncing Duro and Petros and others and preparing the ground for a purge. They knew it. They knew it from January that they were not going to be out long. So they accelerated their efforts to put out their self-critical vision, really. Coming from people who had been part of the repressive apparatus that were now saying the country needs to open up, right? But things were headed in a bad direction, and I was aware of it. So one day, I was sitting in the El Masara Hotel when a young Eritrean came up to me and said, you may not remember me, but I met you in 1977 in Wat Sharife. Yeah, it happens to me a lot. And
My family had just then come from Asmara, and we were on our way out. And then we went from there to the Netherlands, where I learned about the struggle by hearing your reports. I was very touched by this. And he said, that inspired me to become a journalist. So I'm sitting there feeling very good, right? And then he turned to me and he said, I know you know what's going on, you have to say something. And all it took was that small thing. You know what's going on, you have to say something. I say it to everybody here. Now, because it made me stop and think, yes, of course I do know. How long can I wait? And sometimes it only takes that little push to get over it. I gave an interview to one of the local papers. I got called into Hagos's office. I did some more interviews. I got called into Zeinsky's office, and the rest is history. Better late than never. So, let's see. That was one question. My God, you asked two. The opposition parties, any sign of them? Well, that I can give you a shorter answer. Not much. In Miami, Shemelba and others, I've asked people about the opposition. When do you see them? And what people tell me is people come to the camps when they want to recruit us, but they're not doing much. Now, it's partly that Ethiopia is very controlling about who can operate there. So it's not only the parties that are making that judgment. But, and let's say there are also, there's the continuing involvement in Sudan with efforts that started under the ELF with the school that runs there very successfully. There are incidents of activity in camps, but not enough. And I think the community as a whole can play a very powerful role in stepping into that gap and pulling everybody that is concerned about the plight of the people in these situations into helping without regard for political affiliation and who's going to join the movement after that, but just do it because it helps the nation.
That's fine. Short, yeah. Because we are short in time.
Yeah, no, you gotta tell me to be short.
Hi, Dr. Conell. First of all, I would like thanks. We have here in Sweden and hear your history from the beginning of 1917 up to now 2005. And you have been through all this history and you have been through all the Eritrean history. Then to come to my question is, you have been all these camps for these asylum seekers in Ethiopia and Djibouti, and I don't hear about if you have been in Sudan. Comparing to this asylum campus, do you have seen any difference between this in terms of healthcare, education, and other things? This is my first question. And my second question is to come to the COI Commission of Eritrea. Do you have any cooperation with that? You have more involved in this Eritrean situation, and you met them, and you are a testimony. Do you have any cooperation with this commission? My second question. My third question, as my guide mentioned before, what do you see in your point of view the future of Eritrean politics after the tyranny regime in Eritrea? Thank you.
That's a small question. Well, let me take the easier one first. Is there any difference in the situations in the camps, particularly with regard to health? I would say education and health together. And yes, first of all, the Sudan situation, I have not been in the camps. I've been out to Kassala, but I have not been able to get permission from the Sudanese authorities to go into the camps. I was back in Sudan again last May, and I met with refugees there. Some of whom work in the camps, some of whom lived in the camps and came out to talk to me. I talked with UN and other people who are involved in the camps. There aren't really many outside NGOs at all in eastern Sudan, I think, as you know. The Sudan is a very difficult area to get into. Even on my trip to Kassala, I had very limited access to taking pictures, which is why you didn't see them here. I had a permit only to take photographs of monuments. So I had to be very careful. I don't want to show you pictures of monuments. The conditions in the camps are very difficult, as you no doubt heard over the years, from the standpoint of security. The security inside Tagarab, for example, was horrendous for many years, with people being kidnapped, sold out of them by corrupt officials and others. The conditions inside the camps have become more secure with more pressure from outside and from the Khartoum government, I think. But as soon as you step out of the camp to get firewood, to go out and try to work in a garden, you're at risk again. So security is actually a big concern in Sudan, along with the issues of health and education. Sudan is just much more controlled. Ethiopia has better program for the Eritreans than any place that I've been in terms of the security of people and also the programming. The healthcare and other opportunities in the Tigray camps are much better than those in the Afar camps, so there's a difference inside the country. Part of that has to do with the conditions inside Ethiopia. Part of it also is the international community is not present at all in the Afar camps. Djibouti, the Ali Abdi is just outside of everybody's point of view, I think. There are two newer camps, they're actually old ones that have been reopened to deal with the latest influx of refugees in Djibouti. And those camps, with a lot of people coming from Yemen, are getting international and media attention. But the one I showed you out in Ali Abdi, there's almost nobody ever goes out there. So what I said earlier, I would encourage people in the community to try to help build awareness around the variety of needs and geographical spread here so that there's more even distribution, and go to some of the Swedish NGOs to become more involved there. The Commission of Inquiry, I did submit some summary of some of the interviews that I had. That was my only involvement with it. I was also involved as a reviewer of another report that people seem to know much less about, and I would really encourage you to look at it. It was done by the European Asylum Support Office, EASO, if you can remember that. It was produced by people within the Swiss Immigration Services as a kind of broad paper, a report that goes into Eritrean history and geography and politics and culture, setting the scene for it, and then looks at national service, at the political scene, at the issues of religious persecution and others. It is the best documented report that I think is out there. It's much more careful and cautious in its tone, more legalistic than the COI, and it doesn't go as far as the COI and some of its conclusions, but that makes it all the stronger. I think the people who wrote it have been inside Eritrea. This is the only report that draws on people who have been in the country and outside the country. I was actually brought in as a reviewer along with the justice ministries of several European countries. You'll see it in the acknowledgments. I'm the only individual in that. So I had that involvement. I didn't write any of it, but I did get a chance to look at it, critique it, and help it along. I take my job here as one of gathering stories and telling them. I don't have all the answers to Eritrea's future, so I can't really answer that. I have some personal opinions about that, but I don't know that they're worth much more than any of yours. My strongest opinion is the one that I have held for many, many years, and that is that I hope to see an inclusive Eritrea that has room for, as I mentioned earlier, people of all political, religious, and ethnic positions, persuasions, and personal identities. I think that Eritrea remains a country
nation with enormous potential for being a dynamic, multicultural, multi-ethnic model of development. Eritreans are among the most creative, hardworking people that I've ever encountered. And you see it in the refugees, the different creative ways people have found to get out. And sadly, what a waste of enormous opportunity, brain power, and commitment for people who would much prefer to be home building their country. I don't know. You know, that I think at this point, the change in Eritrea is going to have to come from within the country somehow. I think Eritrea is now in a kind of a crisis, and it's an interesting moment where Europeans are experiencing the crisis of the refugees coming out in such large numbers. So is Eritrea. Eritrea is suffering from the loss of virtually it's a whole generation. Think of the hundreds and hundreds of people who have been trained as teachers and sent out to rural areas, and now they're out after 2, 3, 4, 5 years. The continual loss of skilled manpower that has left the country at all levels. The military has been degraded by the loss of many of the young people who make up the troops, many of the middle-level command who have either fled or been arrested or had other problems. I think Eritrea would be hard-pressed if it were seriously challenged from outside to stand up in the ways that it has in the past because of the actions of the present government and the loss of so many people. And I think they're recognizing that. And I think that's one of the reasons you see so many delegations going out to Europe saying, wait a minute, we're changing, we're reforming. National service is going to change in 2016. The current group that's in there will be released. My immediate question when I hear that is, what about all the others who have been in there 18 months or longer? Is there going to be an openly announced end to the Warsaw-Ukalo campaign and a phased demobilization of all the rest? If so, it takes a massive input of resources to find places for people to work. It would take a change in the way the economy is structured to allow for people to find their way into positions where they can support themselves. And it would be a major change that could open the door toward more. So I would encourage those who think about this, take it seriously in Europe, to think not just about one cohort of people getting out, but about the broader changes that need to take place if this is to be a lasting change. And what about those people who have been imprisoned over the years for trying to leave, or being suspected of trying to leave, or being suspected of having a brother or a husband who left? Those people need to be released too. So once you start to open that door, I think there's a short but very powerful list of changes that need to be made. And from there, you know, what I would hope to see is a transition that would take place in which people from all political persuasions could participate in some way in a kind of consultative body that would give Eritrea a breathing spell to start healing and eventually to make a change in the form of government itself. But, you know, this is...
Thank you. A lot of time is now finished.
Great
way to wait.
Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay. لوني متيو على جزيرة كمسي جنتي ناتو حمريتا أبناتو ويب نت متحراتيهم مصحفتيهم كله أقول له جزارة وزنونا ما تخاموا باب تزيون السنة سنزي بوي وتي حتوتات حسرة بنا يا غالي سنزي صباح نبو خيدي بسي صباح نبو نورو تخيص لزواني مبارا مجانا شاح حان تخطط كهبية بارتو الشرط ها Okay? Okay? كنقص لنا بصوت لنا بلاتفورم كنفتر لنا خمسرا تحسيبو لنا بلو لنا حمشتي أربعة سوات لنا نملو معلت قل بقاتا قل يكون قل قلصي ببعنا تنع فستاني قبرا لنا بزا إرتراو تحزين كل مزعبة إرتراو تسمعو نذلل لنا كنمسو لنا إرتراو كنمسينا زي إرتراو كنمسينا ونأتو قدائنا انترناشنال سنزي انتحازنا هي تجي سنة زغيري أبزو مسؤول بعد كسبت دهو سواء كان مسؤول أبزو تازي كي نايدا ولا ناتو وين تداتو بمرو أقول لا أبزو مسؤول ما أما جرشا مسؤول لا حنت التهرب كسبت بحري وات أنت دهان نو نيتو نو كشي أنا تاني فيش
Okay, I just wanted to say that there's clearly not enough time, and part of that is my fault for going on so long. There's just much more to say. Two things. I have a website where many of the things that I've written about the refugee situation are available. It's danconell.net. It's really easy to find. On it, you will find two pages that you can go to. One is articles. And the other is blog. The blog is really just stories of people's experience. And there is also a page for contact. You can email me through that site, so we can all be in touch afterward. The second thing is I want to give a promise that I will do my best to find a way to come back and do a follow-up to this, where we won't have to go through all the history and all the stories. We can just maybe jump right in. So, there will be more opportunity. I really look forward to coming back. I've wanted to be in Sweden for a very long time because I know that the Eritrean community has deep roots here. I'm really pleased and honored to be among you now, but I'll be back.
Okay, thank you. Okay, the last question is for the summary. We'll close it. The last question, and we'll give thanks.
Thank you, Dan. I will make it short. Thank you for the insights. Some of the last pictures were not the nicest ones. But I would like to explore the idea of what you think when families, even villages, are being uprooted in the last years. In my opinion, this could be social, in some countries, it could be described as social catastrophe, which could legally some, especially from United Nations involvement in such occasions. And I would like to explore the idea, what you think about it, how we can insert for the regime to make change. As you said, there are some winds blowing, but the regime has said it a lot of times, but the reform time has gone long time ago. We need pressure. And do you think the situation, when you see the refugee situation today, can you characterize it as a catastrophe?
Okay, final question. I was looking at the UNHCR website earlier today, and they are counting, I believe, 120,000 refugees registered in Sudan. They are counting 110,000 registered in Ethiopia, and there are thousands more in Djibouti. I think we all know that makes more than a quarter million there. The UN officials in Sudan told me that they think that they are registering maybe 40% of those who come across the border. Ethiopia probably gets more, so that's more accurate. But we know that there are many, many people who have left those countries and come to Europe, to North America, to the Middle East, and elsewhere, as far as away as Australia and New Zealand. So let's say there's twice that many who have left. And that's conservative. So we're at 500,000. Most people say Eritrea's population is somewhere between 4 and 6 million. Let's say it's 5 million. If we're talking 10% of a country that is left, if that were Ethiopia, there would be 8 million refugees out. If it were the United States, it would be 35 million who are out. Of course, it's catastrophic at that level, the sheer numbers of people who have left. When you look at decimated entire communities, as you described it, of course, you have a cultural and a social crisis of another order as well. I'm not sure that you're going to get the United Nations to intervene on that basis, but it's certainly an issue to be talking about as you address the wider public. I would ask how many people have learned about how to wage a campaign to get international action from any place else. Where would you look? Eritreans too often are looking inside only instead of at other examples and places to learn from. Eritrea, the government now, is not the only government that's ever behaved this way. I think there are other places we can find similarities and learn from that. But you can also find, I think, models in public responses to these kinds of political and social problems. The one that I think of immediately is apartheid in South Africa, which generated a massive response from around the world. In the end, the regime changed in South Africa, in part because of the movement within South Africa, in part because of the movement outside, and in part the pressure from the international community. It was like a three-pronged pressure. The international community was mobilized around the issue that was easy for many people to get on, and that was the issue of racism, which certainly struck a big chord in the United States. And South Africa was banned from the Olympics over that. It was pressured from outside in many other ways. It was confronted by students and others who organized at their universities to get companies to divest their holdings in companies that did work in South Africa. They weren't members of a political party or an organization, although the ANC played a big role in that. But there were many different people from many different places who worked in the same way around a handful of simple demands. If you were to extrapolate that to Eritrea, it might be what would be the top three things that you might want to see changed in Eritrea? The National Service is one, freeing of political prisoners is another one, the Constitution or some commitment to the rule of law might be another one. Those are things that would resonate widely in the world. Combining the information about the social catastrophe with a simple, clear set of demands for change would be, I think, a campaign that would generate a lot of support. And I would urge people to think about doing that kind of thing rather than only trying to build another vanguard party.
So. Thank you, our audience. Oh, thank you, Professor Dan Conell, for your excellent contributions for the Italian people. And we wish you a long life to continue on this academic track, because the Italians are in need of academic analysis, because academic analysis enlighten us the road towards democracy. And we thank you again, Mr. Al-Azhar, and then we will do it.
Dear Professor Dan Conell, thank you for the excellent contribution for the Eritrean people. Sincerely, Swedish Eritrean Partnership for Democracy and Human Rights. In short, cessado. Thank you.
We will dine now together with our guest, honorary guest, doctor. Then we will have this entertainment and you can discuss each other. And thank you. The last. Okay, Dilara Tariulo, Kendrina, Gashkur Gashana, Sana Hadrero, Hara Majarasha, Kenneth Hanawa. I'm going to go to the boy.
I'm not a man.